Quintus Horatius Flaccus, known in the English-speaking world as Horace, was the leading Roman lyric poet during the time of Augustus. The rhetorician Quintilian regarded his odes as just about the only Latin lyrics worth reading. He can be lofty sometimes, yet he is also full of charm and grace, versatile in his figures, and felicitously daring in his choice of words. Horace also crafted elegant hexameter verses and caustic iambic poetry. The hexameters are amusing yet serious works, friendly in tone, leading the ancient satirist Persius to comment. As his friend laughs, Horace slyly puts his finger on his every fault. Once let in, he plays about the heartstrings. His career coincided with Rome's momentous change from republic to empire. An officer in the Republican army defeated at the Battle of Philippi in 42 BC, he was befriended by Octavian's right-hand man in civil affairs, Maecenas, and became a spokesman for the new regime. For some commentators, his association with the regime was a delicate balance in which he maintained a strong measure of independence, but for others he was, in John Dryden's phrase, a well-mannered court slave. Life. In his writings, he tells us far more about himself, his character, his development, and his way of life than any other great poet in antiquity. Some of the biographical writings contained in his writings can be supplemented from the short but valuable Life of Horace by Suetonius. Childhood. He was born on the 8th of December 65 BC in the Samnite south of Italy. His hometown, Venusia, lay on a trade route in the border region between Apulia and Lucania. Various Italic dialects were spoken in the area, and this perhaps enriched his feeling for language. He could have been familiar with Greek words even as a young boy, and later he poked fun at the jargon of mixed Greek and Oscan spoken in neighboring Canisium. Literary Latin must have sounded to him like a semi-foreign language, heard only at school. One of the works he probably studied in school was the Odyssea of Livius Andronicus. Crammed into Italian boys with threats and floggings by teachers like the Orbilius mentioned in one of his poems, school was made particularly irksome by a number of his fellow pupils, the overgrown sons of beefy centurions. The army veterans could have been settled there at the expense of local families uprooted by Rome as punishment for their part in the social war. Such state-sponsored migration must have added still more linguistic variety to the area. According to a local tradition reported by Horace, a colony of Romans or Latins had been installed in Venusia after the Samnites had been driven out early in the 3rd century. In that case, young Horace could have felt himself to be a Roman, though there are also indications that he regarded himself as a Samnite or Sabellus by birth. Italians in modern and ancient times have always been devoted to their hometowns, even after success in the wider world, and Horace was no different. Images of his childhood setting and references to it are found throughout his poems. Horace's father was probably a Venusian taken captive by Romans in the Social War, or possibly he was descended from a Sabine captured in the Samnite Wars. Either way, he was a slave for at least part of his life. He was evidently a man of strong abilities, however, and managed to gain his freedom and improve his social position. Thus Horace claimed to be the free-born son of a prosperous coactor. The term coactor can denote various roles, such as tax collector, but its use by Horace was explained by Scolia as a reference to coactor argenteras, i.e., an auctioneer with some of the functions of a banker, paying the seller out of his own funds and later recovering the sum with interest from the buyer. The father spent a small fortune on his son's education, eventually accompanying him to Rome to oversee his schooling and moral development. The poet later paid tribute to him in a poem that one modern scholar considers the best memorial by any son to his father. The poem includes this passage: "If my character is flawed by a few minor faults, but is otherwise decent and moral, if you can point out only a few scattered blemishes on an otherwise immaculate surface, if no one can accuse me of greed, or of prurience, or of profligacy, if I live a virtuous life, free of defilement, and if I am to my friends a good friend, my father deserves all the credit. As it is now, he deserves from me unstinting gratitude and praise. I could never be ashamed of such a father, nor do I feel any need, as many people do, to apologize for being a freedman's son. Satires 1.6.65-92. He never mentioned his mother in his verses, and he might not have known much about her. Perhaps she also had been a slave. Adulthood. Horace left Rome, possibly after his father's death, and continued his formal education in Athens, a great center of learning in the ancient world, where he arrived at 19 years of age, enrolling in the academy. Founded by Plato, the academy was now dominated by Epicureans and Stoics, whose theories and practices made a deep impression on the young man from Venusia. Meanwhile, he mixed and lounged about with the elite of Roman youth, such as Marcus, the idle son of Cicero, and the Pompeius to whom he later addressed a poem. It was in Athens, too, that he probably acquired deep familiarity with the ancient tradition of Greek lyric poetry, at that time largely the preserve of grammarians and academic specialists. Rome's troubles following the assassination of Julius Caesar were soon to catch up with him. Marcus Junius Brutus came to Athens seeking support for a republican cause. Brutus was feted around town in grand receptions, and he made a point of attending academic lectures, all the while recruiting supporters among the impressionable young men studying there, including Horace. An educated young Roman could begin military service high in the ranks, and Horace was made tribunus militum, a post usually reserved for men of senatorial or equestrian rank, and which seems to have inspired jealousy among his well-born confederates. He learned the basics of military life while on the march, particularly in the wilds of northern Greece, whose rugged scenery became a backdrop to some of his later poems. It was there in 42 BC that Octavian and his associate Mark Antony crushed the Republican forces at the Battle of Philippi. Horace later recorded it as a day of embarrassment for himself, when he fled without his shield, but allowance should be made for his self-deprecating humor. Moreover, the incident allowed him to identify himself with some famous poets who had long ago abandoned their shields in battle, notably his heroes Alcaeus and Archilochus. The comparison with the latter poet is uncanny. Archilochus lost his shield in a part of Thrace near Philippi, and he was deeply involved in the Greek colonization of Thasos, where Horace's die-hard comrades finally surrendered. Octavian offered an early amnesty to his opponents, and Horace quickly accepted it. On returning to Italy, he was confronted with yet another loss. His father's estate in Venusia was one of many throughout Italy to be confiscated for the settlement of veterans. Horace later claimed that he was reduced to poverty, and this led him to try his hand at poetry. In reality, there was no money to be had from versifying. At best, it offered future prospects through contacts with other poets and their patrons among the rich. Meanwhile, he obtained the sinecure of scriba quaestorius, a civil service position at the aerarium or treasury, profitable enough to be purchased even by members of the ordo equestre and not very demanding in its workload, since tasks could be delegated to scriba or permanent clerks. It was about this time that he began writing his satires and epides. Poet. The epides belong to the iambic genre of blame poetry, written to shame fellow citizens into a sense of their social obligations. Horace modeled these poems on the work of Archilochus. Social bonds in Rome had been decaying since the destruction of Carthage a little more than 100 years earlier, due to the vast wealth that could be gained by plunder and corruption, and the troubles were magnified by rivalry between Julius Caesar, Mark Antony and confederates like Sextus Pompey, all jockeying for a bigger share of the spoils. One modern scholar has counted a dozen civil wars in the 100 years leading up to 31 BC, including the Spartacus Rebellion, 8 years before Horace's birth. As the heirs to Hellenistic culture, Horace and his fellow Romans were not well prepared to deal with these problems. At bottom, all the problems that the times were stirring up were of a social nature, which the Hellenistic thinkers were ill-qualified to grapple with. Some of them censured oppression of the poor by the rich, but they gave no practical lead, though they may have hoped to see well-meaning rulers doing so. Philosophy was drifting into absorption in self, a quest for private contentedness, to be achieved by self-control and restraint, without much regard for the fate of a disintegrating community. V.G. Kiernan in Horace's Hellenistic background is clear in his satires, even though the genre was unique to Latin literature. He brought to it a style and outlook suited to the social and ethical issues confronting Rome, but he changed its role from public social engagement to private meditation. Meanwhile, he was beginning to interest Octavian's supporters, a gradual process described by him in one of his satires. The way was opened for him by his friend, the poet Virgil, who had gained admission into the privileged circle around Mycenae, Octavian's lieutenant, following the success of his eclogues. An introduction soon followed, and after a discreet interval, Horace too was accepted. He depicted the process as an honorable one, based on merit and mutual respect, eventually leading to true friendship, and there is reason to believe that his relationship was genuinely friendly, not just with Mycenae but afterwards with Augustus as well. On the other hand, the poet has been unsympathetically described by one scholar as a sharp and rising young man, with an eye to the main chance. There were advantages on both sides. Horace gained encouragement and material support. The politicians gained a hold on a potential dissident. His republican sympathies and his role at Philippi may have caused him some pangs of remorse over his new status. However, most Romans considered the civil wars to be the result of contentia dignitatis, or rivalry between the foremost families of the city, and he too seems to have accepted the Principate as Rome's last hope for much-needed peace. In 37 BC, Horace accompanied Mycenae on a journey to Brundisium, described in one of his poems as a series of amusing incidents and charming encounters with other friends along the way, such as Virgil. In fact, the journey was political in its motivation, with Mycenae en route to negotiate the Treaty of Tarentum with Antony, a fact Horace artfully keeps from the reader. Horace was probably also with Mycenae on one of Octavian's naval expeditions against the piratical Sextus Pompeius, which ended in a disastrous storm off Palinurus in 36 BC, briefly alluded to by Horace in terms of near drowning. There are also some indications in his verses that he was with Mycenae at the Battle of Actium in 31 BC, where Octavian defeated his great rival, Antony. By then Horace had already received from Mycenae the famous gift of his Sabine farm, probably not long after the publication of the first book of satires. The gift, which included income from 5 tenants, may have ended his career at the treasury, or at least allowed him to give it less time and energy. It signaled his identification with the Octavian regime. Yet, in the second book of satires that soon followed, he continued the apolitical stance of the first book. By this time, he had attained the status of Equus Romanus, perhaps as a result of his work at the treasury. Nitodes 1-3 were the next focus for his artistic creativity. He adapted their forms and themes from Greek lyric poetry of the 7th and 6th centuries BC. The fragmented nature of the Greek world had enabled his literary heroes to express themselves freely, and his semi-retirement from the treasury in Rome to his own estate in the Sabine Hills perhaps empowered him to some extent also. Yet even when his lyrics touched on public affairs, they reinforced the importance of private life. Nevertheless, his work in the period 3027 BC began to show his closeness to the regime and his sensitivity to its developing ideology. In Odes 1.2, for example, he eulogized Octavian in hyperboles that echo Hellenistic court poetry. The name Augustus, which Octavian assumed in January 27 BC, is first attested in Odes 3.3 and 3.5. In the period 27-24 BC, political allusions in the Odes concentrated on foreign wars in Britain, Arabia, Spain and Parthia. He greeted Augustus on his return to Rome in 24 BC as a beloved ruler upon whose good health he depended for his own happiness. The public reception of Odes 1-3 disappointed him, however. He attributed the lack of success to jealousy among imperial courtiers and to his isolation from literary cliques. Perhaps it was disappointment that led him to put aside the genre in favor of verse letters. He addressed his first book of epistles to a variety of friends and acquaintances in an urbane style reflecting his new social status as a knight. In the opening poem, he professed a deeper interest in moral philosophy than poetry, but though the collection demonstrates a leaning towards Stoic theory, it reveals no sustained thinking about ethics. Maecenas was still the dominant confidant, but Horace had now begun to assert his own independence, suavely declining constant invitations to attend his patron. In the final poem of the first book of epistles, he revealed himself to be 44 years old in the consulship of Lollius and Lepidus, i.e., 21 BC, and of small stature, fond of the sun, prematurely grey, quick-tempered but easily placated. According to Suetonius, the second book of epistles was prompted by Augustus, who desired a verse epistle to be addressed to himself. Augustus was in fact a prolific letter writer and he once asked Horace to be his personal secretary. Horace refused the secretarial role but complied with the emperor's request for a verse letter. The letter to Augustus may have been slow in coming, being published possibly as late as 11 BC. It celebrated, among other things, the 15 BC military victories of his stepsons, Drusus and Tiberius. Yet it and the following letter were largely devoted to literary theory and criticism. The literary theme was explored still further in Ars Poetica, published separately but written in the form of an epistle and sometimes referred to as Epistles 2.3. He was also commissioned to write odes commemorating the victories of Drusus and Tiberius and one to be sung in a temple of Apollo for the secular games, a long-abandoned festival that Augustus revived in accordance with his policy of recreating ancient customs. Suetonius recorded some gossip about Horace's sexual activities late in life, involving mirrors. The poet died at 56 years of age, not long after his friend Maecenas, near whose tomb he was laid to rest. Both men bequeathed their property to Augustus, an honor that the emperor expected of his friends.